for her is an ICSA direct initiative that focuses on how women are taking charge of their financial well-being. In this series today, I have with me a very special guest, Ms. Nanalal Kidwai, who is chairperson, India Advisory Board, Advent Private Equity. Ms. Kidwai has several firsts to her name. The first Indian woman to get an MBA from Harvard, first women president of FICCI, first women to head a foreign bank's operations in India. And now she works for causes including environment, sanitation, access to water, and women empowerment. Welcome, Ms. Kidwai.
Thank you. Thank you, Geetu.
What does women empowerment mean to you, ma'am? What institutional and societal changes are needed to work towards empowering women in our country?
You know, Geetu, empowerment of women works at many levels. I have seen it work very successfully at the self-help group level with organizations like SEVA, and how by bringing economic benefit and livelihood to women, they are made to stand on their own feet and become a voice in society. And equally, for those of us who are in the workplace, the corporate workplace, empowerment is about taking control of our lives. So when we work in careers, being able to manage that career in a way that works for us. Society has changed, fortunately, from way back in 1982, when I came back after my MBA and joined Grindbay's Bank. It's a very different place today. But I'm also saddened to say that it has not changed enough, that there are still issues. And there's, in fact, an interesting, I think it was an India Today survey, which showed that about 70% of the family, so men, in-laws, etc., were very happy to see the woman go to work. But 60% still believed that her role was to make sure that everything at home was okay. So this is this tough expectation. It's fine, you can go to work, do what you like, but you have to be the home manager. And it has been so obvious over this whole COVID crisis, where surveys, I'll quote one that FICCI did with the UN, in fact, showed that women have been spending at least 4 hours, 3 to 4 hours of their time through the COVID crisis on home management, working women. Because children are at home, schooling, husbands are at home, domestic help is an issue. So here is a working woman working from home and managing house and home and work. And it's getting extremely stressed through it. So this is the societal expectation that must change, where the family must pitch in, where the expectation, and frankly, I'm still of a generation where if I don't do it, I feel very guilty. Mm-hmm. You have to conquer this guilt and know that it is, we can't be superwoman and juggle all these balls in the air.
Very true, ma'am. If we talk about the women, make up 50% of workforce, but they make up very small fraction of leadership positions in most of the industries. Does this need to change and how?
Of course it needs to change. And it is disappointing that we lose so many in the middle and not everyone comes back. And we know why they go. They go largely because it's a time when family gets precedence, children. And then coming back to the workplace is not easy. Now, many organizations have now created programs where the outreach is there to bring talented women back into the workplace. The issues are enormous because to come back, you may have lost ground vis-a-vis colleagues. If you've been away for more than a year or two, to go back and be junior to your cohort, these are not easy things to stomach. And organizations have to also adapt and change to this as much as we, as women, when we make these choices. I don't think the choice is wrong. Each to them, we all have different situations. We take that choice knowing that it's not going to be easy coming back into the workplace. But the sooner we can be back, the better. I will only say that we shouldn't give up. Come back, whether it's to that organization or whether you decide to become an entrepreneur or startup, and there have been many successful stories of such, but don't exit the workplace when you have the skill sets you do. Because for everything that you do, outside of managing and looking after your family benefits from it. And I don't just mean the monetary benefit. That I know that today, and I asked my 30-year-old daughter, and of course my husband 100 times, as to, you know, could I have done something differently? And I know that from the heart, they grumble, but they would not have wanted it otherwise. So it's not impossible to manage this, but you have to put your heart and soul in it. I always say it's like two crystal balls, the crystal ball of work and the crystal ball of home. And to me, both these crystal balls are important. So you just learn to juggle both. And you know they're made of crystals, so you dare not let them fall, because if they fall, they're going to shatter. There's a third ball. It's the rubber ball, the me ball, the ball which I can let drop. And because it's made of rubber, it's not going to break. It's the ball which, you know, the one that I enjoy music, I enjoy my me time. And in this book I put together, 30 Women CEOs, their voices, their stories, some of the women disagreed with me. They thought the me ball was also a critical ball. So they were trying to juggle three balls in the air. I managed okay with two and treated this rubber ball as one that I could pick up when I had the time to indulge that part of me that also needed indulging.
And you just touched upon a book that you have authored, 30 Women in Power. What inspired you to really write about these women? And, you know, what is the stories that, one could, aspire for from these?
So it was really to showcase success. And I was very struck by the fact that at that time, we had, of course, and always had a number of senior women in the financial services sector. But there were indeed multinational IT companies in India, all of whom heads were women. But when I asked my friends, who are all largely in business, if they could name who was the head of, these were companies like IBM and Capgemini and, you know, really well-known names, they couldn't name the head. And vice versa, if I named the person, they couldn't tell me where she belonged. So it told me that we had some wonderful stories out there, but these women were so talented, working hard, but they had their heads down and they were below everyone's radar and they had a story to tell. So it was really cajoling and coaxing them to tell their stories. And my challenge was, of course, keeping the financial sector down to just three or four women and making sure that we could highlight those in media, in IT and across sectors to tell their stories.
Ma'am, for a future that is sustainable, we need women at every table where decisions are being made, be it home or workplace. Your thoughts on the same?
So, you know, I think the key to success for an organization today, for a company, is not to tick the box and talk about the numbers, the diversity and the inclusiveness, which I think most companies today embrace and certainly talk about. The difference between the one that treats it as a tick box exercise and the one that truly embraces it is what makes the difference. And to truly embrace it, the organization, and I mean everyone, not just the CEO, have to believe that having diversity in the organization, having diversity at the top table, the people who directly report to you, is good business. It brings insights, it brings viewpoints that are critical, and you don't want yes men at the top table. You want people who will disagree nicely, ultimately go along with the rest when you take a decision, but who will voice a view and have a view that is different to everybody else there. And we have seen that the performance of companies that have truly embraced diversity, whether it is bottom line and revenue or in terms of market cap, because the market also really respects the companies that get this right. It is a win-win for the companies that get it right. But the embracing of diversity has to be for the right reasons. It makes good business sense.
Very true. Women today are faced with many challenges, from resisting social expectations to adopting a new culture. Do you believe mentors play a very critical and crucial role in supporting women at workplace?
I think mentors play a role for men and women. I have been part of mentorship programs that ran through the organization. And indeed, that is the way a mentorship program should be run. It shouldn't just be for the women. It should be for everyone. And each person needs someone as a guide. And in the true sort of way that mentors work. It's not a direct boss, it's someone who sits much further away from your direct line and chain of command. In itself, I didn't work in organizations that had mentorship programs. I brought them in much later when I was CEO, but I wasn't, unfortunately, the beneficiary of such a program. I would like to believe that it is something which companies embrace and use. Having said that, we can find our mentors. I mean, did I not have mentors? Did I formally call them mentors? No. But I knew where I could go for support and help for different situations. When I was changing jobs, who was I going to go to? And I didn't want to leave because I was very happy in the organization I was in. I'm being headhunted. I was at Morgan Stanley, very happy there. But I'm being asked to join HSBC. So I actually said no initially. And now I'm being pressed to join and being read a lot of interesting things about what it could mean for me. And I was confused. So I pick two or three people who are CEOs and chairmen themselves, who understand the world that I work in, and ask them, what do you think? Should I make this choice? And that in itself, that mentorship is important because you trust that individual to give you advice, which because they sit outside the organization and they only have your welfare at heart. A mentor can be, you know, certainly my father was, and everyone's parent has to be a mentor at some level, teachers. I think we learn from people we work with all the time. So in small ways and big ways, we have to seek what it is that is working for others and learn from that. And equally, learn from what we don't like. We come across people and, you know, you're like, well, I don't want to be like that person. I really don't like my boss and I certainly don't want to be a boss like him. So you also learn from what you don't want to be. And it's always about keeping yourself, your listening ears, your eyes open and picking up the right things that then become the amalgam that is you.
How important is it, ma'am, for women to be financially independent?
Well, I think hugely important. I think the freedom it gives us to decide for ourselves and the power that it brings is so enormous, but it brings its challenges too, because you can have a partner who doesn't earn as much as you, your career versus his career. All these issues come with their baggage as well. But I have found, whether it was with the self-help group at Seva or women who worked and brought that not just economic value back to the organization, but the spirit, the independence, the education just made for a better family, because the influences at home end up being wider and bigger. And therefore, I think having that independence is important. Now, that independence does not always have to come from the fact that you work and you earn. I think to me that is important, but it can also be about the power that is placed in you by the family to not just manage the kitchen, but to maybe run the finances, to learn how you invest, where you save. These are all critical aspects. And I think the role that organizations such as ICICI, ICICI Direct can play is also skilling women in financial management.
Right. Ma'am, what advice will you give to lots of young women who are watching this show and aspiring to be as successful as you are?
Well, I don't know about as successful, but my advice would always be don't give up. That you will be in situations where you are down and out. There are times when we all fail, but just remember that at the end of the day, getting up and trying again is important. And the organization should also be one that empowers and helps you do that. And I'm very sad to say that not many organizations recognize that a mistake that is not malified can be a mistake where a lesson is well learned. But at any rate, it shouldn't get you down. And the second is that there is no end to learning. It isn't about that MBA degree. I mean, you know, if you ask me today, what do I remember what I learned there? It's nothing. However, what you learn is how to learn. And I'll end by saying that one of my favorite Sanskrit slogans is Mahastavira Sangharakshita. To know what we do not know is the beginning of wisdom. So recognize that we do not know a lot of things, and that perennial learning, that curiosity, that search for knowledge must drive us.
Thank you very much for being with us, ma'am. It was a pleasure speaking with you.
Yeah, thank you, Geetu. This was very engaging, and good luck to all of you. Yeah,
thank
bye.
You.